Hello friends, now I'll be starting with a discussion of diuretics, and I am taking up the diuretics along the site which they act. So the ones which act on the proximal convoluted tubule, I'll be taking that first. So to understand the role of the diuretics here, we need to understand the mechanisms which are functional in this proximal convoluted tubule. So for you, I have made this diagram of a normal PCT cell. This side is the luminal side and this side is the interstitial space. So the filtrate, it is coming in the lumen, and how these things, they are reabsorbed, that I will be discussing, and then how the diuretics, they play their role, that will be discussed in this video. So the very first thing which you have to remember is this channel here, this is the basolateral membrane. So in this basolateral side, there is one channel which we call as the sodium potassium ATPase, and this is, you know, this breaks down ATP, so it is energy requiring, and what it does is it removes sodium from the cell and provides potassium inside the cell. So this process is actually against the concentration gradient, so it requires energy. So this is one channel which you need to remember, and this is the one driving force for most of the other activities which are occurring here. So when this pump is functional, you can imagine that the levels of sodium inside this cell will be low, so they will drive the movement of sodium inside. Okay, and the first channel which makes use of this is here, this channel, and this channel is, you can call it, sodium hydrogen exchanger, or NHE. And what does this do? It is an antiport. Antiport means it takes sodium inside from the lumen into the cell and removes one hydrogen into the lumen. Okay, so the process is not electrogenic, because a positive ion is exchanged for another positive ion. But the thing is, sodium goes inside and hydrogen comes out, and you know hydrogen is responsible for the acid base. But that can be also dealt with later on. But more important thing is, this hydrogen combines with the filtered bicarbonate. Okay, so this bicarbonate which is coming in the tubular fluid, it binds with this hydrogen and forms H2CO3, what we call as carbonic acid. And this carbonic acid, then by means of this enzyme, what we call as carbonic anhydrase, it is broken down into water and carbon dioxide. Okay, otherwise there is no mechanism to absorb bicarbonate from this side, because there is no channel for bicarbonate on the luminal side. So this water and carbon dioxide, now carbon dioxide, you know, carbon dioxide is a gas and it is lipophilic, so it can easily pass through the membrane and it goes inside the this tubular cell. Okay, so this carbon dioxide, you can see it moves inside. When it moves inside, what happens is it again combines with water, again forms carbonic acid, again with the help of carbonic anhydrase. But the subtype is different. The subtype which is responsible for breakdown in the lumen, it is called as type 4, carbonic anhydrase type 4, which is present here on the membrane of the tubular cell, while the other carbonic anhydrase is soluble. It is present in the cytoplasm, and that is subtype 2. Okay, but anyways, the thing is, again carbon dioxide combines with water forming carbonic acid, and this carbonic acid, what happens is it then is split into a hydrogen ion and a bicarbonate ion. So hydrogen ion, it then by means of this channel NHE, it is again pushed out to catch the hold of another bicarbonate ion. So hydrogen in a way is recycled. Okay, so hydrogen is being pushed out, another bicarbonate picked up, and this cycle keeps on repeating itself. So what is the end result of this? You get an excess of bicarbonate ions inside the luminal cell. That is fine. Now what happens is, there is one symporter. Now you have got an excess of bicarbonate inside the cell, and it goes down its concentration gradient into the interstitial space, taking along sodium by means of a symporter. So sodium bicarbonate is removed from this cell into the interstitial space. So this is how sodium is reabsorbed, bicarbonate is reabsorbed, and other things, they are recycled like this. Now, since you have taken most of the sodium as well as sodium, sodium came from here, so sodium is reabsorbed, bicarbonate reabsorbed, all these things reabsorb and they go into the interstitial space. Now what happens here? In the lumen, there is now a relative excess of another anion, and that is chloride. So chloride becomes in excess in this. And what happens is, so when chloride is in excess, obviously there forms a concentration gradient across this towards the interstitial space. So what happens? Chloride takes what we call as a paracellular pathway through the cells. Through the paracellular pathway, this chloride, it is also transported all the way into the interstitial space. So this is how chloride is also reabsorbed. Some of the chloride is also exchanged for certain organic bases, so which is responsible for delivery of most of the drugs, including the diuretics themselves, into the tubules. Okay, so this is about the physiology, or you can say the mechanisms which are functional in the proximal convoluted tubule. So now we could block this at various points, but the only mechanism which we have available and which is used as a diuretic is by blocking this enzyme, that is the carbonic anhydrase. So now when we block this enzyme, what will happen? So you can see it will not be converted into water and carbon dioxide. So carbon dioxide will not be reabsorbed, and then it will not be converted into proton and all this. So the bicarbonate will be lost as such. So there will be excess of bicarbonate which will be lost in the urine. Okay, and when excess of bicarbonate is lost, you know, bicarbonate is responsible for alkalosis. So there will be alkaline urine. So one thing you will find is the urine will be alkaline. Okay, now when the urine is alkaline, what will happen in the body? There will be acidosis, because bicarbonate has gone in excess, so there will be excess of protons left in the body. So it will lead to a condition what we call as a metabolic acidosis. Okay, so this is, you can say this is one of the side effects of this class of drugs, carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. Okay, and carbonic anhydrase is not only responsible in the proximal convoluted tubule, it is also helpful for delivery of protons in the intercalated cells of the collecting tubules, and that's why again it can contribute to acidosis, because there will be no exit of protons from the body, so the protons will be retained in the body. That's why it can lead to, it can further lead to metabolic acidosis. So this is one adverse effect with this carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. Okay, so what happens is, bicarbonate will be the main anion which will be provided in the urine will be bicarbonate, along with the sodium will also not be reabsorbed because there is no hydrogen to exchange, so sodium will also come out. But since we are acting at a very proximal site in the tubules, most of these electrolytes, they are reabsorbed at a later stage. Okay, but still there is marginal increase in the excretion of
sodium.
And whenever there is increase in the concentration of sodium, whenever more sodium reaches the distal tubule or the collecting tubule, what happens is it is exchanged for either potassium or hydrogen. Now, since hydrogen has been blocked by this carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, there is an excess of loss of potassium from the distal tubule in exchange for sodium. So, sodium is reabsorbed and a lot of potassium is lost, which leads to a problem called as, what will happen in the body is, there will be loss of potassium, which we call as hypokalemia. So, that is another adverse effect which we see with this. Okay, then one more thing is, it also, carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, they also interfere with the release of one ion which we called as NH4+, that is ammonium ion. So, the ammonia which is produced, that is also unable to enter into the tubule, or you can say it is unable to be secreted. So, when this is not secreted, what will happen? Hepatic encephalopathy, it can be worsened, because ammonia is the major factor which leads to hepatic encephalopathy. So that can also, so encephalopathy or hepatic coma, it can be worsened. So that is another problem with this carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. Now, these carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, they are weak diuretics. They are not very strong, because I have told you most of the electrolytes, they are later on reabsorbed here or there. So not very, they cannot be given as a monotherapy. They have to be given along with other agents, and their primary indication is never for, or you can say they are never used, not used much as a diuretic. They are more importantly used in other sites where also carbonic anhydrase is important, and one such site is, one such action is, or one such indication is glaucoma. So there is one very important role where carbonic anhydrase inhibitors are given, and that is glaucoma. In glaucoma, what happens is, in glaucoma, generally there is an imbalance between aqueous secretion and aqueous reabsorption. So, these carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, they interfere with the secretion of aqueous, because in the secretion of aqueous, the main electrolyte which is pushed into which forms the aqueous humor is bicarbonate itself, and obviously this bicarbonate is generated by the action of carbonic anhydrase. So when this bicarbonate goes low, obviously the secretion also goes low. That is one important indication of carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, rather than their use as a diuretic. Then another indication is, we do not know how it acts, but very important indication is mountain sickness. In mountain sickness, you know, whenever the oxygen tension becomes less, the body tends to feel drowsy, and there are many symptoms of this mountain sickness, and those symptoms, they are relieved when we give acetylzolamide, which is a carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, as a prophylactic measure. So mountain sickness may be because it causes metabolic acidosis, that's why it is beneficial in mountain sickness. Then again, another indication is epilepsy. In epilepsy, you know, in epilepsy there is increased firing from the CNS neurons. So by creating a condition of acidosis, it suppresses the threshold. So the threshold is, you can say, the threshold is increased. So epileptic seizures, they are somehow reduced. So these are some other indications than primarily their diuretic action, where these agents they can be used. Thank you so much. I will be taking up other diuretics soon. Thank you so much.